And they took up 12 baskets full of broken pieces left over. And those who ate were about 5,000 men, besides women and children.
Marcia, thank you so much. Would you join with me, please, in a moment of prayer? O Lord, may the words of my mouth and the meditation of my heart be acceptable to you, O Lord, my rock and my redeemer. O source of peace and harmony in the universe, grant peace to us and to the household of Israel. Amen. Oh. We have a saying here, Bonnie has used it, and I'm so glad to get the good news about her recovery and return. I know you will, we all are. But we have a saying, and Bonnie has repeated it more than once here, about this church. And that is, the saying is, if you feed them, they will come. And this morning we're going to certainly be able to experience that because Tanya's prepared a wonderful meal for us after church. But you know, food is a component, really, and plays a close part, and has for a long time, in religion and in Christianity. It's very interesting to think about it. Adam ate the apple. That's what got us started in trouble in the first place. The Jewish Passover in the Old Testament centers on the Seder meal. Teresa prepared the Seder meal for all of us when we came here for Bible study one night. And actually, I had a preview of it privately once, which was wonderful. In Christianity, we are told that Jesus is the bread of life. In the Lord's Prayer, we ask that God, you know, well, give us this day our daily bread. We learn the spiritual value of fasting or giving up certain foods for certain periods. And first Sunday of every month, here in this church, we have communion. Partaking in bread and wine or juice that symbolizes Christ's life and spirit. There are two stories in the New Testament that center on food. And that is the feeding of the 5,000 in Matthew, which Marcia just read for us. And the feeding of another occasion, 4,000. Nice round numbers. Described in Matthew also. And these are considered, these feedings of these multitudes, two of the miracles of Christ. The stories of the feeding of the 5,000 and the feeding of the 4,000 parallel each other in many ways. The feeding of the 4,000 is also known as the miracle of 7 loaves and a fish. It's reported in Mark and Matthew, but not in Luke or John. But the feeding of the 5,000, which is what we read from today, known as the miracle of 5 loaves and 2 fish, is reported in all 4 Gospels, Matthew, Mark, Luke, and John, and is thus the only miracle that is repeated in all 4 of those Gospels. other than the resurrection of Christ. It's the second story, then, the feeding of the 5,000, that I want to consider with you this morning. Now, recently, Bonnie has been preaching on the ministry and the miracles of Jesus. And this morning, I want to continue in that vein. So this, then, is the rest of the story. The story is, when Jesus had heard that John the Baptist had been killed, he departed to go away, to grieve, to be on his own with his disciples. And the report in Matthew is he took a ship to a desert place apart so he could be alone and quiet for mourning. But when the people had heard where he went, they followed him on foot. He went out of the cities into the country to find him and be with him. And when Jesus saw this multitude, according to Scripture, he was moved with compassion towards them. Bonnie talked about this a Sunday or two ago. And he healed their sick. Now, it had been a long day, the boat ride, getting ashore, having all these people come and find him, healing all the sick. They were tired. Jesus was, the disciples were, all those people were, because they had to go on foot. And they were hungry. It was evening. Jesus' disciples, seeing all these people, and they were hungry and they were tired, said, Jesus, they told him, send these people away so they can find food. But these were poor people. They hadn't brought food with them. They had been sent away, discarded, put off, marginalized all their lives. Go somewhere else, they'd been told. And so, Jesus replied, they need not depart. Keep them here. And he said to his disciples, give ye them to eat. But the disciples said, we have barely enough for ourselves. We only have 5 loaves and 2 fishes. He said, it's okay, bring them to me. And he had everyone sit down, all 5,000 people, disciples. He took these 5 loaves, these 2 fish, probably he could hold them in his 2 hands, perhaps they were in a basket. And he lifted them up. And looking up to heaven, he blessed that food and he broke it into pieces. He began breaking it into pieces. And he gave them back to his disciples and they passed out the food to the multitude. And the book of Matthew reports they, 5,000, did all eat and were satisfied. A miracle indeed. What are we to think of miracles? I remember a church in upstate New York, where I lived for a good part of my adult life. And in the dining room, there was a banner on the wall. A Sunday school class, I think, had made it, and they took felt, and they cut things out, and they pasted it on the banner. It was probably about the size of the one that we have back here on the wall. And on it was a picture of a basket, and it had bread and had fish in the basket. And below the picture of the basket appeared these words. Very interesting. Love is like a basket with five loaves and two fish. There's never enough until you give it away. But wait, there's more to the story of the feeding of the 5,000. After they did all eat and were satisfied, the book of Matthew goes on to tell us the miracle was not over. There was one more thing to be done. This is very important. This is the reason I like the book of Matthew account in particular. Jesus directed the disciples to gather up all the leftovers. And, quote, they took up the fragments that remained, 12 baskets full. Now that's a miracle. The story is not about 5 loaves and 2 fish. It's not about the miracle of multiplying. It's not about feeding 5,000. And that didn't include women and children. The story, my friends, is about the food that remained. There was 12 times as much as what they started with. After feeding everyone. The hungry people were important to Jesus. The 5 loaves and 2 fish were important to Jesus. Feeding the multitude was important to Jesus. But ultimately, what was important to Jesus was that he told his disciples to gather up and bring to him the broken pieces that remained. Nothing was to go to waste. Nothing was useless. Nothing was to be thrown away. Nothing was expendable. The pieces were as important, if not more so, than the whole loaves or fish. Everything had a place and a use. Everything was needed. Everything was special and holy. Everything was valuable and was to serve a good purpose. Those of you who have heard me leading group discussions and things know that I sometimes quote Henry Nouwen. And his book, Life of the Beloved, was life-changing for me. And there are a few books that I can say that about. Nouwen is a Jesuit priest. He talks about the sacrament of communion, we already mentioned this morning. And he says there are 4 stages to communion. First, the bread is chosen by the priest. Second, it's blessed. Third, it's broken. And fourth, it's given. And now one makes the observation that there are also four stages in our lives. In our lives, we're chosen by God. And it begins just when we are born. We're chosen to be here, like Dean. Next, we are blessed. We all live under a blessing. And next, Dallin says something that seems a little odd at first. He says that it's with the bread in communion, in our lives, we have to be broken in some way. He argues that each of us is broken in a slightly different and special way. It's what makes us different. It's what gives us character. It's what can be appealing and becoming to others. Ultimately, it's what makes us useful to others, allowing us to be able to empathize with them and be truly loving. Our brokenness, he says, reveals something about who we are. And I want to quote this because it's so good. For each human being suffers in a way that no other human being suffers. And he goes on to say, and this is interesting for a Jesuit priest to say, our brokenness is often most painfully experienced with regard to our sexuality. There are all kinds of brokenness, including physical and mental disabilities. But now it concludes, and again I'm reading, the suffering of which I am most aware on a day-to-day basis is the suffering of the broken heart. Again and again, he says, I see the immense pain of broken relationships between husbands and wives, parents and children, lovers, friends, and colleagues. The suffering that seems to be most painful is that of feeling rejected, ignored, despised, and left alone. Why would Jesus not consent to telling the crowd to depart? Because he didn't want them to be rejected and abandoned. Has anyone here ever felt rejected and left alone? Has anyone here ever felt rejected and left alone? In communion, only the bread that's broken, my friends, can be distributed and given to the worshipers. Now it insists that so too in life. It's only when we are broken that we can be given to others and be real and useful to them. In another of his books entitled The Wounded Healer, provoking title, Nowen argues that the person who has been wounded themselves can be an empathetic and believable counselor and friend. Now, how do we do this? How do we use our brokenness? We all know we've experienced that. How do we use it? Now it says, first, we have to face our brokenness squarely and befriended. Second, we have to put our brokenness under a blessing. It happened for some good. Thank you, God, I can use this. We realize that whatever adversity has happened to us, whatever tragedy and suffering we have experienced, can become a source of purification, pruning, and discipline. In the Old Testament, Joseph, the story of Joseph, is quoted in many colors. And you know the story. His brothers sell him into slavery. Poor Joseph, there he goes. End of story? No, it's the beginning of the story. Joseph says to his brothers, when he meets them later, he says, "You meant evil against me, but God meant it for good." And good came out of it, as we know. In the New Testament, the Apostle Paul puts it this way, "And we know that all things work together for good in them that love God." So the glass is seen not as half empty anymore, but as half full. And in time, we will be able to say with the psalmist, "My cup runneth over." So, my friends, I say to you that regardless of the trials and struggles in your lives, regardless of the pain and the hurt, the losses and the disappointments, the failure and the heartache, there can be value and purpose and redemption. Let us not throw away the broken pieces. Let us carefully and gently gather them all together for the true banquet of life. Nothing is for naught. Nothing is useless. Nothing is wasted. Nothing is lost. We need all the broken fragments. The pieces are as important as the loaf, for what is the loaf except a composite of the pieces? Everything that's happened to us can be used for good. Everything is special and holy. Everything is valuable and can serve a purpose. And that, my friends, is the miracle of the feeding of the 5,000.